I'm Elaine Ruffalo. I'm a Renaissance art historian.
The young Michelangelo. Michelangelo is universally recognized to be one of the greatest artists of all time. He was a supremely gifted sculptor, painter, architect, and a very fine poet. He had an incredibly successful career and he made a fortune. In fact, no member of the Buonarroti family ever had to work again for the next 300 years. I just think that's incredible. Thanks to Michelangelo, he raised the status of an artisan, someone who works with his hands, from the level of craftsman, you know, the same level as, say, a shoemaker or a carpenter, to the level of artist, which would be the same level as, say, a writer or a poet. And of course, Michelangelo himself is going to raise his level from artist to divine genius. And he loved to nurture that idea that somehow he was divine. He lived nearly 89 years, three times the life expectancy of a man in the Renaissance. And his career spanned the glories of the Renaissance in Florence, the discovery of the New World, the Reformation, the stirrings of the Counter-Reformation, and the very inklings of the period of the Baroque. Now, many believe that Michelangelo's talent was somehow miraculous, and he emerged untrained as a genius. But of course, Michelangelo learned his craft just like any other artist. He trained under masters, he opened up his mind and his heart to new ideas, and that's the period that I'd like to discuss today, the young Michelangelo, specifically the period from 1475 to 1504. All right, so let's get our resources down, and we have two primary resources, meaning that they were alive at the time that Michelangelo was alive and they were writing about him. One, I know you all know because I've talked about him ad nauseum, Giorgio Vasari, who wrote The Lives of the Artists. And he was a good friend of Michelangelo. He wrote about Michelangelo, but apparently Michelangelo didn't think he was flattering enough. So Michelangelo in his 70s will commission a guy named Ascanio Condivi to write a second version where Michelangelo comes out even better. And then Vasari writes a second version as well. So everybody's writing about Michelangelo, kind of perpetuating this myth of genius. I shouldn't even say myth, that he was a genius. I wanted to bring that up because we have so much written about Michelangelo, but we always have to be a little bit careful because both Vasari and Condivi will try to put Michelangelo always in the very best light possible. Our other sources are Michelangelo's letters, which were extensive, especially back and forth to his family members, first to his father and then extensively to his brother. So what we know about Michelangelo's early life, the young Michelangelo, is going to be that he was born in 1475 in March 6, in an area called the Val Tiberina, which means the Valley of the Tiber. And there it is, it's beautiful, isn't it? It's east of Florence, it's just on the edges of the Apennines. I'll show you a map so you can pinpoint it. Here's Florence where my cursor is. This is Sansepolcro, that might be familiar to you, just below Caprese. Sansepolcro is where Piero della Francesca is from. Also note where Arezzo is. Here's Arezzo, that's where Vasari was born. And Michelangelo was born in this tiny little village, you could throw a stone across it, called Caprese. Now, for kind of a funny reason, for several generations, the Buonarroti were bankers in Florence. But the Buonarroti bank failed, and Michelangelo's father, whose name was Lodovico di Leonardo Buonarroti, he needed some money, and so he took a government post in Caprese, where Michelangelo was born. Michelangelo was the second son. Michelangelo's mother was Francesca di Neri del Miniato di Siena, which just tells you all the places that her family came from, ultimately from Siena. But the Buonarroti family on the father's side claimed to be descendants of Matilda of Canossa, which is, you know, aristocracy. Now, it's unproven, but it's something that Michelangelo believed in his heart, and he tried to perpetuate that. This is where Michelangelo was born, but just when he was probably 4 months old, the family is going to move back to Florence. Now, Michelangelo, because the family was of not quite aristocracy, but not very poor, they were just hard on their luck. Michelangelo was sent off not to live with the family, but he was sent off to be wet nursed from a nutria, in Italian they're called. And that was typical of the time that babies were sent off to be wet nursed, coming back to their family when they're 3 years old. And so Michelangelo was essentially brought up outside of Florence in a town called Settignano. And this picture I actually took just the other day hiking. This is in Settignano. Settignano is maybe on a fast walk, 50 minutes from the Duomo. It's immediately up in the hills, and it's famous for all the gray stone that you see here on the lower right-hand side. This gray stone is called Mancino, and it's a kind of stone that most of Florence is constructed with. There's also a gray stone, it's called Pietra Serena, serene gray stone. Therefore, Michelangelo's wet nurse was his nanny. Her husband was a stone cutter, her father was a stone cutter, her grandfather was a stone cutter, and this is how Michelangelo said he took in the milk of stone cutting. You know, it's a little bit Michelangelesque hyperbole, but we see if there's some good in me, it's because I was born in the subtle atmosphere of your country of Arezzo. He's writing this to Vasari. Along with the milk of my wet nurse, I received the knack of handling chisel and hammer with which I make my figures. Now you see what I mean about Vasari. He makes it all very romantic. And that's how the talent came in, with the breast milk of a stone mason's daughter. Now, as a young boy, Michelangelo will eventually be sent back to his home. He's the second son of five. The mother dies when Michelangelo's only 6 years old, and that tells you, you know, how many babies this woman had, one after another. And as a young boy, he would be sent to Florence to eventually receive a humanist education because of the status of the family. Comes into Florence, and here's Florence, of course, in the end of the 15th century. I mean, wow, what a place to come to study. But rather than learning his letters and arithmetic and geometry and Latin and Greek, Michelangelo preferred to spend his time wandering through the streets and copying works of art, infinitely more satisfying to him. And here's what he could have seen in Florence: Donatello's St. George, which was right on the outside of Or San Michele. We know that Michelangelo went inside the Brancacci Chapel and he was blown away by Masaccio. On the right-hand side, Andrea de Verrocchio's Doubting Thomas was just being placed outside, maybe assisted by Leonardo. And this is the kind of work that Michelangelo would have been walking through the streets that were just, you know, crackling with competition and new ideas. He wasn't interested in going to school. For him, school was looking at works of art. I'll remind you, this is the period that Botticelli was painting for the Medici family. And Michelangelo will eventually be able to see these paintings when he moves in with the Medici family. And to make an important point, these are mythological stories. Mythology has become all the rage at this point. Remember, Constantinople falls to the Turks in 1453. Where did the intelligentsia come? They came to Florence. And of course, new ideas, translations are common of these mythological stories. And I think that inspires Michelangelo. And then, of course, to name the elephant in the piazza, this is the period of Leonardo's, who comes from Vinci, of course, when he's only 12 years old. He's about almost a little over 20 years older than Michelangelo, and he's already made his mark in the city of Florence. And Michelangelo's got to deal with, of course, Leonardo as the great, you know, shadow that looms over him. But of course, he definitely rose to the occasion. All right, so his training, his education at this point is less a formal one than it is opening his eyes and his mind to new ideas. But apparently, according to Vasari, Michelangelo's father was not keen on this, and they went back and forth and had terrible fights. Vasari will tell us that Leonardo Buonarroti beat Michelangelo because he wanted Michelangelo to be a notary or a banker. His first son became a friar, which is unusual. But in any case, he needed one of the kids to go on to support the family. They went back and forth, until Michelangelo finally got his way, and he was apprenticed here at the Church of Santa Maria Novella. He was only 12 years old, and he is taken on as an apprentice under the hottest fresco painter in Florence, Domenico Ghirlandaio. How was he able to do this? Because